I'm very excited because our Porsche's bodywork is all prepped up and ready for its respray, but because it's such a special car, I want the very best paint job we can possibly get. So I'm here at a professional body shop where Dick, hello Dick,
hi,
is going to do the respraying for us. Now, from my experience, the next stage on this is masking up, and then of course you can put on your primer.
Yes, but in this particular case, Ed, we need to isolate the car. Unfortunately, the car's got some history, and looking at it, it looks as though it's been painted at least two or three times previously. To overcome any possible problems when we paint the vehicle, we have to put an isolating coat on it, which seals the surface of the paint,
okay, and
stops any reaction at a later date. Then we can prime it as per normal.
Okay, that sounds reasonably complicated. So I better get on with the masking up then, I suppose.
Yes, well, we can start right away, Ed.
Here's
the tape.
You're going to help, though.
Just.
Masking up a car isn't terribly difficult, but it is terribly important. This spray job is going to be comfortably over £1,000, and getting the masking wrong means that the paint won't cover all the bits it needs to. So rather than throw away money, use a roll of thick brown paper and take a long time getting this right.
Now, obviously, we don't want to get paint on the wheel arches here, or the wheels themselves, but of course, actually more important is there's loads of bits of dirt and grit in here, and the power of the air coming out of the gun will actually blow all this dust onto the paintworks. It's very important that all this area is masked off as well. Well, check out the suit. It's almost like a forensic suit because this next stage is all about cleanliness. Now that we've masked up the entire car, the only bits that are showing are the bits that are going to get painted, but I've got to be very careful. There are no bits of dust and flakes and things all over the rest of the surface, so I'm going to clean it off. But the reason for this suit is to stop any more fibres from me getting onto our now clean surface. So the first stage is a bit of pre-clean. I'm going to put that onto a rag here. I'm going to go over the whole car with this stuff. And then I need to wipe it off, and then after a bit of tack clothing, we'll be ready for the isolator. Well, the excitement's mounting because the isolator layer is now ready. It's dry, so now Dick is going over with the primer. He's going to do a couple of coats of that. Once that's done, it's going to dry overnight, bit of flatting off, and then we're ready for top coat.
The primer goes on in at least two coats and is left to dry overnight.
Well, that's looking great.
Nearly there.
Fantastic. As you can see, Dick has been very busy since we last left this car. First of all, once the primer was dry, he's actually gone over it and flatted it off with 800 wet and dry paper. Then he's put all the doors, bonnet and tailgate on because it's very difficult to fit them once they're all painted without damaging them. So to stop that, they're all fitted in place now. And then as you can also see, there's a little bit of overspray here where he's been doing all the shot lines because again, it's very difficult to get access to those while he's painting the top coat.
The final stage before this car goes brown is to go over it with a tack cloth. That's a sticky pad which prepares the surface for top coat.
This is a glorious moment for our Porsche. It's come back from the body shop coated in this delicious chocolate brown paint. The shine is so deep, the lines are so accentuated by this. I just can't wait to put this car back together. So careful putting all these parts on because the paint is still a bit fresh and therefore it might chip quite easily.
This is why a full respray is so expensive. It involves plenty of meticulous, time-consuming procedures. Usually at this stage, I'd be replacing a large number of rusty screws and seals, but this car is rock solid engineering and it all goes back together fine.
With the rear and front bumpers firmly secured to the car, you can now see how they complete these sumptuous curves of our 928.
The body looks great, but the wheels are still letting us down, so I've sent Mike out to get me some original ones from a Porsche salvage specialist. These are the teledials after Mike's pal has finished with them. They literally look like new. Fantastic!
These rims are such a find. Our Porsche is already looking stunning and wheels can make or break a vehicle. With our refurbished teledials, we're going to dramatically increase the value of our Porsche for a minimal outlay. Let's just get them on the car.
The tyres on the car are okay, but we'll be replacing them with a new set to give buyers more confidence.
Our Porsche would have rolled out of the factory with this very style of wheels. It's only fitting that it should roll out of our workshop as the designers intended. Now, I've still got a whole load of work to finish before that happens.
As usual, it's the small things that take up the time. Every hinge, light fitting and moving part needs to be checked and rechecked to make sure it's still working as it should.
Now this is the rear quarter glass, and you might remember that when I took this off, I actually cut the rubbers to shreds just to get it out without breaking it. So this is a brand new rubber. So the next stage is to get this into the car, but there's actually a clever way of doing this. I'm going to get hold of some paracord. Now this is the string that holds you to a parachute, and it's quite thick and it's quite strong. So what I'm going to do is actually feed this into the rubber of the glass, run it around here, and the idea is, once I've got the window into the car, actually then pull the string out, and what happens is the lip of the rubber kind of folds over the metal edge, and that way I actually get the window into position without damaging the rubber. So it's quite cunning. Now first of all, I'm going to try and get the bottom edge of the rubber over the metal lip to give myself a bit of a head start. Okay, I've got to make sure that, of course, all the paracord is inside the car, and now I'm going to go inside and do the rest from in there. To gently pull out the paracord, and that pulls the rubber lip over the edge of the metal. It certainly pays to be patient with this kind of job, because otherwise you can end up having to start all over again or having to buy more rubbers. So, and there we have it, one window in the back of the car.
And with the windscreen trims back in place, the exterior of our 928 is sorted.
Ever since Mike bought this car, we've had a problem with the headlights. They don't pop up and they don't come on. Now, if it's not a minor problem, we could be looking at hundreds of pounds to fix this. Luckily, I've got a friend in the trade who knows a thing or two about Porsches, and he suggested that the headlight switch is a common failing point of these cars. And I've managed to get hold of a salvage one that's been proven to work, and I'm desperately hoping that this will fix it. If it doesn't, we could be looking at a huge bill.
Don't bother to ask how much a new switch would be if you could get one, but this unit only costs £20. Bearing in mind a new motor for the headlights would cost hundreds, it's a cheap fix if it works.
Okay, so here's the moment of truth. Let there be light. This 928 has been a real labour of love. It's been a joy to work on. It really is the epitome of quality German engineering and style. Even over 25 years on, it still looks and holds its own as a supercar. It definitely deserves the Porsche badge.
And that finishing touch marks the end to this car's transformation and how great it looks. Better than great. This car is superb.
Click here to subscribe.